So since 2017, last year, we are giving this session on how to integrate current affairs with your sociology syllabus. But there is one key difference between last year 2017 session on this and this year session, because this year session is not only on one day, it will be spread across from 2 to 3 classes, minimum 3 classes, maximum 4 classes I am planning, because last time in the free session class we have done 27 topics and many students have also told that they were able to integrate this thing in their writing, and that is why a trend which I am seeing, which is very positive trend, that students have started scoring equal marks in paper 1 as well as paper 2. So as it, when it comes to your paper 2 stuff, more and more India centric current affairs you have to write. When it comes to paper 1 stuff, it is not wrong to write India centric current affairs. You can still quote India centric current affairs in paper 1 as well. For example, Immanuel Durkheim's theory of religion is asked to be applied to Indian society. So we can speak about the rising nationalism or a consciousness based on religion, and what are the outcomes of this hyper nationalism which we are trying. So is it providing organic solidarity as what Immanuel Durkheim said, or it is only creating pathology? So that is how you have to link hyper nationalism which is in the news with that of the theories, especially the thinkers portion, right? So I have identified some 80 to 100 topics which can be done for current affairs, and we will do in phases, right? For example, today is the first session. Next week we'll have the same session on Saturdays, on Saturday, and subsequently we'll have on Sunday. So I will inform you about the next session, which is likely on the coming Saturday, I think 11th of August. Today is 11th of August, you'll have the second session, right? I have told you that we wanted something to do extra, because only by doing extra, we can become extraordinary. Ordinary becomes extraordinary only when we do something extra. Sometimes we may not be aware of the current affairs stuff which comes, which can be integrated with sociology. I am not trying to put everything whichever you are reading in the newspaper into this topic called as integrating sociology with current affairs. I have identified the topics which is having little bit of overdosage of sociological content. Because when you write the sociology paper, you know, it has to be little bit overdosage. You can't lightly write the examination and come ask for 300 plus. If we lightly write the examination, they'll give you a score which is very light. We wanted a strong score, we have to have little bit of extra dosage of sociology, and that is what is the expectation of UPSC when they are putting the statement instruction that write from sociological perspective, especially paper 2. So when I am seeing the newspaper, when I am browsing all the available literature as far as the current affairs is concerned, I am not selecting each and everything which comes. I am selecting only based on a yardstick which UPSC has given. This yardstick is nothing but UPSC syllabus. So I have done superimposition of the sociology syllabus with what is coming in the newspaper, with what comes in the opinion, or what comes in important current affairs magazines, especially Frontline, EPW, etc., etc. So after superimposition, I could find exact matching of the syllabus with the current, and these are the topics which I have handpicked. So today I have decided to do some 20 topics on the sociological components which have come in the form of current affairs, right? Always when we wanted to become what we are not, we have to little bit invest extra energy. So if you do something which you have not done, we will get what we do not have. That is what is the basic philosophy which you have to follow when you prepare. We wanted to become IAS because we don't have this IAS. If we wanted to get something which we do not have, we have to do something which we have not done. So doing something which we have not done so far is what is that thing which we are doing today, that consciously linking current affairs with sociology. Right? Always, when you read the newspaper, you have the sociology syllabus beside the newspaper and try to superimpose. From my analysis, I have selected the topics. You can also do the same exercise, and you can also throw a number of extra topics which can also be added to our hit list topics. Right? With respect to writing the answer, the strategy is very simple. First, write the long answers, then you write the short notes. Divide the time into two equal halves, say 80 minutes, because 20 minutes you have to give for reading the question paper and other stuffs like this. So 80 minutes, you do all the 6 long answers, and 80 minutes, you do the 13 short notes. If you could add current affairs to almost all the 19 questions in paper 1 and 19 questions in paper 2, even if we get half a mark extra in every question, we'll get some 20 marks extra in sociology. So our idea should be, our target should be crossing 300 easily. 300 should be crossed easily, because only when we cross 300, we will get into IAS. Your optional score becomes the trump card in the recent times. If you analyze some 10 years of the result, those who have cleared the examination, they have cleared the examination mainly because of the optional score. So here where we have to become extra productive, which will translate easily into the marks, right? So 300 plus. If you think you can, you can. If you think you cannot, you cannot. So go by the philosophy of non-positivism. Think that you can, you will definitely get, right? The first topic, in fact, most of the time when we select the topics which comes in the newspaper in the form of the opinion and all, we come to know that one theme is very much predominantly present. I spoke about how inequality is becoming one important topic which comes in the newspaper again and again. Structural inequality, whether it is tribal society coming in the news, for example, tribal poverty, particularly vulnerable tribal groups came in the news. Gender-based inequality came in the news. And the poverty, which is most importantly debatable topic today, poverty. So when we browse through, when we, when you try to maneuver the current affairs, you are seeing one important topic which can be easily linked with sociology is social stratification topic. Social stratification topic. When it comes to paper 1, it is Marxism, social stratification. And when you come to paper 2, it is nothing but social structure and social change. So these are the connected topics in paper 1 and paper 2. Social stratification, or unit number 4, Marxism, plus social stratification. Because in social stratification only, you speak about poverty, inequality, and social exclusion. Then go to, paper 2, social structure, where you see the structure which is present. And paper 2, section C, the structural changes which are taking place. So all the issues which are coming in the newspaper, whether it is the farmers' protest, or it is sexual harassment, or it is the anti-beggary law which is criticized, you can relate all these things with the social structure. So social structure study is what is sociology, we know. Structure study is what is sociology. And the structure, whether it is changing or it is not changing, or it has started changing, but it has not completely changed. So this is what is the dimension present in all the current affairs systems. structure changing, the structure not fully changing, the structure refusing to change. The structure is again reinforced by the economic liberalization or the economic idea called as capitalism. Right? So understand this. Structure study is what we are studying in the current affairs. Various structures are present. Gender structure is present. Caste structure is present. Class structure is present. Then, you know, other racial structure is present. Ethnicity structure is present. So how these structure studies are to be noted, how this structure study will have to be done through current affairs. Start with the list of topics. I have just told you the structure study is what we are doing in the form of integrating current affairs with sociology. Karl Marx is the unit which is very, very relevant in the current affairs. And stratification mobility, social stratification, unit number 5, paper 1. Most of the topics you can, you know, current affairs topics can be linked to the social stratification, then Marxism, and then, you know, class structure. Again, I told class structure or structure study in paper 2. The first topic is, it came in the current affairs. An economist, Marxian economist, his name is Kalyan Sanyal. He writes about poverty present in India. Poverty is a central theme present in study of society. Last year, there was a question. Poverty, inequality, deprivation happens to be the major challenge when Indian society is undergoing transformation. You have to analyze this. Right? So study of poverty, linking poverty to social structure is very, very permeating in nature. Everywhere you have to do this poverty study and tagging this poverty study with the structure study, social structure study. There are certain jargons which has to be noted down by you. Because otherwise our answer will become very diluted. So jargons will have to be noted down. It has to be consciously revised by you, contemplated by you, and you should be involved in the process of how to write this jargon in this topic. That you have to do it consciously, then only in the examination, you will write the jargon. Otherwise, you will end up writing very dilutedly, which will not help you to score 300+. Right? There is a phrase which you have called as legitimization of accumulation. What do you mean by legitimization of accumulation? Right? Capitalism is transferring some portions of surplus to the poor people. The vulnerable people, to tell that capitalism is giving to poor also. So Marx already told that there may be many strategies used by the capitalists to prevent a class conflict. So legitimization of accumulation is a phrase which was used by Kalyan Sanyal, a Marxist economist, who writes about the nature of poverty in India, which was coming in the current affairs. Legitimization of accumulation. In order to prevent social conflict, in order to prevent social political disruption. So, use this in Marxism, use this in poverty, use this in social mobility, and also in caste system. Right? Understood what is legitimization of accumulation? Giving some surplus to the poor people to legitimize exploitation. So I have used another term. I have borrowed the term from Kalyan Sanyal, a term called as hegemony of capital. Hegemony of capital should be preserved. Hegemony means domination is acceptable by those who are getting dominated. So for hegemony of capital to be preserved, that is legitimization of simulation, right? But in the lines of Marx, it is only what? False class consciousness. David Harvey writes about primitive accumulation and dispossession. Primitive accumulation and dispossession. Land Acquisition Act came and it was criticized for a number of reasons. We have inserted 31A by the First Amendment Act 1951. This 31A in the Constitution gives power to the state called as Doctrine of Eminent Domain. Using the Doctrine of Eminent Domain, state can, you know, buy, take the property of the poor. State can compulsorily acquire the property. Right? Now, what is happening is, primitive accumulation means, we will go to the agricultural farmers who are owning some land. We will try to enclose the land. We will expel the resident population. And these resident, these expelled population, dislocated population will become proletariat. And this enclosed land will be given to private people. So this is what is happening in many of the projects. In the name of developmental projects, what actually happens is primitive accumulation and dispossession happens. Right? Special economic zones are constructed, created for attracting the foreign investors and to give a big push to the private sector, because after capitalism came, it is the private sector which is going to give employment. State ceases to be an employment provider. Now you have to give tax holidays, you have to give a plethora of concessions to the corporate world. So they'll ask you, like Singur, they'll ask you 1,000 acres of land. I wanted to start my nano car factory. So government will go enclose the land of the poor people, evict them out, and they become landless people. And now enclose the land, give that land to the private sector, so that the private sector can use the land for accumulation of their profit. So all rehabilitation related issues or displacement related problems, there is a topic, displacement, sustainable development, in the 7th unit of section C, paper 2. 40% of the tribal population were the victims out of 100. 40% of the dispossessed population or tribal population. Walter Fernandez writes about this. So anything related to land, anything related to land acquisition, anything related to agriculture, anything related to developmental projects, you have to use this concept of David Harvey, primitive accumulation and dispossession. Dispossession means you are possessing something, that is possession, holding something. Dispossession means you are thrown out, right? This dispossession of land is very, very important problem to be studied today. A number of farmers protest happens in India in the recent times. A spate of farmers protest. They are on one hand, they are asking for certain agrarian reforms. Most importantly, they are asking for land security. So dispossession and primitive accumulation is what is happening in the name of development. Development for few people, displacement or dispossession for the original inhabitants of the land. And that is why there is increasing tendency of conflicts present, unrest present, whether it is tribal conflict or agrarian conflict or maybe even the conflict related to the regional groups, dispossession and primitive accumulation, right? So anything related to an important project which is concerning clearance of the land, evicting people. You can use this concept used by David Harvey, primitive accumulation and dispossession. Land is the main means of production in India. If you are displaced from the land, then definitely it results to so much of marginalization or deprivation. Half of the rural households are landless. Socioeconomic caste census. Socioeconomic caste census speaks about multiple types of deprivation. Landlessness, homelessness, right? So half of the rural households are not the owners of the land, and that is why agriculture is failing. Next topic is, in fact, what Karl Marx says on the role of women in revolution or social movement, which also came in the newspaper, right? Chattopadhyay is the author of this article, which came in the recent times. He is speaking about recalling a letter which was written by Karl Marx to his friend Louis Kugelman. In that letter, Marx writes that great upheavals are not possible without feminist or feminine ferment. So this is what the key word which you have to use when you are using when you are writing about feminist movement, then you have to write about feminine ferment. And he says, social progress is exactly measured by the social status of the beautiful sex. So he speaks about women as an important component of social or political upheaval. When the question is on women empowerment, when the question is on women's movement, then definitely you can use the Marxian term called as feminine ferment to speak about the need for empowerment of women for the empowerment of the society. Right? Chattopadhyay writes about or recalls about Marx writing a letter to his friend. So we can use this in, you know, gender as the basis of stratification, which is there in unit number 5, paper 1. You can use it in patriarchy and sexual division of labor, unit number 1, unit number 9, paper 1. You can use it in paper 2, especially with respect to the feminist movement and also violence against women, right? Feminine ferment, social status of the beautiful sex. Marx is writing about uneasy tension between two forces. One is historic force, another is systemic force, right? When you look at some sort of industrial conflicts present today, when you see the industrial conflicts which are present today, or when you see even a tribal movement, a revolution or a protest, you can use this term that the historical forces conflicting with the systemic forces. Historic forces wanting change. That is what is historical materialism. History is wanting change in the material forces. So historical forces wanted change, whereas the systemic forces do not want change. Systemic forces here means the mode of production. And this is what is leading to conflict. So conflict is leading to pulling apart what was earlier functionally united. Dalit consciousness, which is rising today, can also be written applying this Marxian perspective. Right? I have given another topic, one or two topics on this, how the status of Dalits in Bihar is improving, what is sociology in that in the recent times, and why Dalits protested against the Supreme Court verdict, which was diluting the SCST protection, prevention of atrocities or protection against atrocities act. So the point is functionally united. in the name of caste system, lower caste and upper caste are functionally united. For example, Jajmani system. You can write this in the dominant caste theory, which was used by M.N. Srinivas. Earlier, the lower caste people were functionally united, linked to the upper caste people. But what happens today? They are pulling apart from each other, because the historical forces wanted change. The systemic forces don't want change. So this is what is unfolding the dialectical materialism. Know the news. Just know the news. When you read, you have some news about social structure, inequality, poverty, all these stuffs. Then try to apply Marxian perspective. Right? I always advise you to little bit write more sociology in sociology paper, so that when he reads your paper, he should not find any reason for reducing the mark. As a matter of right, you have to demand your marks. My mark is 300 plus. Because reality is, if we get 300, less than 300, we will be cat on the wall as far as the service is concerned. We'll get some service, but still we will not get what we wanted. So crossing 300 only can make you IAS. Right? When you read a protest, there is a protest. They will not write all the sociology in that protest and all. They'll give you the place where protest took place. When you read, use this and try to apply this thing. Try to apply this thing. Right? So, this is what you need to do. So, I've told you that pulling apart of what is functionally united. The third topic is ecological imperialism, which again came in the analysis, newspaper analysis. A topic called as ecological imperialism. You can write in environmental movement, which is there in social movement in paper 2. And you can write in sustainability, sustainable development, rehabilitation, 7th unit of paper 2, section C. So these are the areas where you are going to use the ecological imperialism concept. Grabbing of natural resources. Monopolistic rent. Right? Monopolistic rent. Huge profit comes, which is unchallenged to the owners by exploiting the natural resources. Appropriating the use value of nature. Nature is giving you use value. Nature's products gives you use values. So the owner is appropriating the products which gives use value. Nature's products which gives use values. Unsustainable dumping of the waste. Unsustainable dumping of the waste. In fact, when we go and see the problem of the people, especially those people who are in the littoral states, very poor, littorally located people, they are the victims of the pollution which was committed by the corporate world. Understood? Financialization of financial superstructure. This is another term which you can use. Financialization of financial superstructure. What is the meaning of financialization? Nothing but expansion. Instead of writing expansion of financial infrastructure, we can write financialization of financial infrastructure. And these becomes the exploitative structure of capitalism, right? Using the use value of the nature's products, dumping the toxic waste in the nature, grabbing the land and expanding their financial base, and that is what is called as financialization of the financial superstructure. And also, these will lead to increasing exploitation from the institution itself. There is an exploitation which is happening. So exploitative institutional structure. Why we are today talking about the Paris Climate Accord? Why global warming becomes a very important threat today? Because these are the problems accentuated by capitalism. So today the mean sea level is rising. We are fearing that we will experience some catastrophic effect due to the climate change. Poor countries are becoming even more vulnerable. They wanted the fund coming from the rich country called as Green Climate Fund. And rich country refuses to give $100 billion per year to the Green Climate Fund. When Ebola virus attacked, the rich countries were not able to mobilize the fund which was required by WHO. So this is how vulnerability of the poor countries or vulnerability of the poor population keeps rising. Globalization of capitalism has only resulted in ecological imperialism. Nature becomes a commodity which is exploited for profit. Nature is becoming a commodity which is exploited for profit, and that is what is resulting in the increase of the ecological footprint or the increase of the carbon footprint today. Ecological footprint increases, carbon footprint increases because of this reason. Right? A number of conventions, international conventions, which wanted the countries to stop dumping the toxic waste, which comes in the news. It may be a convention like a persistent organic pollutant, Stockholm convention, right? So like this, Cartagena protocol, Agenda 21, all these are the counter currents created against ecological imperialism. These are counter currents created against ecological imperialism, which is the handwork of capitalism. Right? So environment related damage, the disaster management stuff which when you are reading, most of the disasters are man-made disasters, and these man-made disasters started increasing after capitalism came. Next topic is Thomas Piketty, Capital in 21st Century. He says that except for a brief period of time, inequality was increasing between the top and the bottom percentile. He says that West inequality in the West first fell between 1910 to 1970. But post 1970, inequality in the West started increasing. So this is the time period, means post 1970 only, they are expanding their financial base. Financialization of economy happens. And in case of India, there is present expansion of the financial base as well as crony capitalism. What do you mean by crony capitalism? Capital in 21st Century is a book, very famous book written by Thomas Piketty in 2014, which created so much of intellectual or academic waves, ripples. Which resulted in the debate about the relevance of Marxism in the contemporary times. And he also prepared, along with Lucas Chancel, this World Inequality Report 2018. Rising inequality in India is a product of financialization and crony capitalism. What do you mean by crony capitalism? Crony capitalism means you are not growing your business because of your business acumen. You are growing your business because of contacts. So because of contacts only you are increasing your business. And here where you have to bring which capitalism? Dalit capitalism. Dalit capitalism is unable to pick up because of the reason that they don't have the social capital. They don't have the network to expand their business empire. Business, every business inevitably grows because of contacts. So contact is the capital. As Reliance, Kesh Ambani says, data is the new oil. Data is nothing but a contact only. So if you are accessing data, you own capital. Owning data is owning capital. And the poor people don't own this capital called as contact, as well as those in the lower bottom of the caste system, they also do not own this social capital. World Inequality Report 2018, prepared by Lucas Chancel and Thomas Piketty. From 1922 onwards, when you calculate the income inequality is maximum in the present times. Look at the top 1% of the Indian population. What is their share of the national income? In 1922, 21% of the national income was accrued by, appropriated by the top 1%. And in 1980s, it became percentage. And today, it has become 22%. So, 1951 to 1980, the share of the super rich, it was declining. But post 1980, the share of the super rich in the national income tremendously increased. You have to look at how this is mainly because of capitalism, because we intensively started practicing capitalism only from 1991. Right? Inequality in income, inequality in wealth, inequality in income, inequality in wealth keeps on increasing. Inequality in consumption, it is reducing. So this is something which you have to look at today. Inequality in income, Dr. C. Rangarajan speaks about this in his recent article. Inequality in income is rising. Inequality in wealth also rises. But inequality in consumption declining. In fact, the consumption rate is increasing for the bottom decile in comparison to the top decile. Top 10% you compare, bottom 10% of Indian population you compare. Today, the consumption rate of the bottom 10% kept expanding in comparison to the consumption rate expansion of the top 10%. Which means that capitalism is promoting consumerism. That is why all started consuming, especially consumer base started increasing, and India is the second largest consumption market next only to China. So this is the systematic design of capitalism. Tells you to consume whatever is available. Consume all the products of capitalism. So capitalism gives you money, and money comes to your pocket. From pocket, money goes to the market through expansion of consumerism. And consumerism is what is becoming a value system today. Exactly, Marx told this thing. Value system present in the superstructure is guided by the motive of the infrastructure. So mode of production will dictate terms and conditions to the superstructure called as value system to cater to the interest of the bourgeois who own the mode of production. Consumerism is advocated today. So consumption inequality reduces. All money whichever a poor person earns, he is spending in the form of consumption. He has little money to invest in the revenue yielding asset, and that is the reason why wealth inequality expands, whereas consumption inequality reduces. Capitalism is only resulting in, borrowing the words of Thorstein Veblen, conspicuous consumption, over consumption. Right? From 1950s to 1980, decline in the share of the super rich in India, but from 1980 to 2014, the share of the super rich started increasing. Right? So this alarming increase in inequality, alarming increase in inequality, is the systematic design of globalization and capitalism. Another estimation, Anand Thampi estimation, top 1% of India accounted for 28% of India's wealth in 2012, whereas it was only 17% in 1991. In the same period, share of the bottom 40% reduced from 5% to 4%. So, the share of the national income for the bottommost population reduced from 5% to 4% between 1991 to 2012, whereas the share of the top 1% increased by 11% when compared to 1991 data. 28% is the share of the top 1% in 2012, and it was only 17% in 1991. Right? So expansion of inequality is what is present in this World Inequality Report. And similarly, there was an investment bank called as Credit Suisse Investment Bank, which says that top 1% accounts for more than 50% of the country's wealth. So top 1% is having control over 50% of our national wealth, and this is defying the socialist character of the state, which we have given in the directive principles of state policy or not. So the nature of the welfare state which is in place today, or the socialist component which we have added in part 4 of the constitution, is severely questioned because of the rising inequality. What 39B says, what 39C says, what is really happening is a matter of worry. So when welfare state is present, protest will not be there. When only there is no welfare state, only when the role of the welfare state reduces, then naturally protest will be there. There is one topic in your polity and society, political system, unit number 7 of paper 1, collective mobilization, protest, revolution, movement, all these topics you can add this point that rising inequality is the condition for today's protest. And absence of welfare state. So, when you don't have welfare state, are we really a democratic country? And when socialist character is reducing, then what we have declared in preamble, we are not following. Right? So, rising inequality, what is to be used in movements, protest, collective action, Marxism, social mobility, and increasing challenges to social transformation as far as paper 2 is concerned. Gaon Bandh, farmers from many states, especially Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh, they went for a massive strike in 2018 June. 172 farmers organization, they declared that they are stopping all the produce, agricultural produce, to the major cities. On one hand, they wanted to tell the government that do some agrarian reforms. At the same time, they also wanted to tell their urban counterparts that inequality between the urban and the rural increasing. Farmers' movement, basically because of agrarian crisis as well as the increasing rural-urban divide. Because the urban wage rate keeps on increasing. In proportion to that, the rural wage rate is reducing. And there are so many people from the rural area, they are migrating to the city. And that results in city having today congestion problem, slum problem, unemployment problem, and that is also leading to, in the theory of R.K. Merton, he speaks about deviance as caused by the social structure. Social problems are emanating because of unemployment and scarcity of resources in the urban places. Oscar Lewis speaks about culture of poverty in the urban places. So they have decided, we will not give any of our produce, agricultural produce, to the urban counterparts. And June 10th, 2018, they decided to have a Bharat Band. All over India, Bharat Band. In fact, how they are using technology, you know, using social media network, they are reaching to 10 lakh population, asking 10 lakh people to come for protest. So this is the impact of technology on social change. There is one topic in your 10th unit paper 1, science, technology and social change. You can use this thing in science, technology and social change. How using mass media, they are trying to get connected to masses to solicit the support for their protest. And last year, 2017, 6 farmers were killed by police action when they went for similar protest. Mandsaur police firing. There was, they remembered that last year, by this time only, 6 farmers were shot killed by the police force when they went for protest, agrarian protest. So police repression as a consequence, as a reply to protest, is speaking about the absence of democratic political culture present in India. You can use this stuff even in polity and society, means unit number 7 of your unit number 7 of your paper 1. Civil society, it is, farmers are coming together, they are trying to become a revolutionary force. Use it in the farmers movement in paper 2. A number of times they have asked, what are the salient features of farmers movement today? What are the salient features? Earlier, farmers movement was having a singular strategy, a singular leadership, a singular ideology. But however, Karl Marx says that farmers in India, peasants in India, are not having revolutionary potential. But Barrington Moore and other scholars have spoken about farmers movement in India. Kapil Kumar has spoken about farmers movement in India, how farmers have become revolutionary. And in fact, Kathleen Goff speaks about farmers movement. Kathleen Goff speaks about farmers movement, that they can become revolutionary force like that of the class. They are true class. They have today become class for itself. So these are the things which you can write when the question is on, the role of democracy or the welfare state. You can ask, you can write this on farmers movement or agrarian unrest. Right? There is something called as, in the social structure of paper 2, agrarian social structure. Then there is something called as farmers movement in the social movements topic given in paper 2. So I am telling you, whatever topics we are discussing in this current affairs session, sociology current affairs session, these topics are like salt, can be used. This is to be used. But only thing is, consciously you have to revise to include it in your answers. I told you, half a mark extra. Without writing this, I will not get that half extra. Writing this, I'll get half extra per question. I'll improve my score by 20. If I am 280, I'll become 300. If I am 300, I'll become 320. Right? What are the demands made by these farmers? They wanted the minimum support price to be increased 50% higher than all the input cost. They wanted this recommendation of MS Swaminathan Commission to be fully implemented. They wanted high price for milk procurement. They wanted higher price for the milk procurement, and they wanted loan waivers. But remember that loan waiver is not a permanent solution for the farmers' unrest or farmer suicide, because very few farmers only have availed institutional credit facility. Loan waiver will only solve the problem if you have taken loan from institution, but if you have taken loan from non-institutional agencies like the local money lender, loan waiver is not a solution. That is why when the UPA government was giving a massive loan waiver of say 60,000 crore in one year, that year itself in Maharashtra, 8,000 farmers committed suicide. This is a clear indication that loan waiver is not a solution. It is not the panacea for the problem, because there is no inclusiveness in the financial system. So you have to bring what? Inclusive growth. Who are not linked to bank? Poor people are not linked to bank. Women are not linked to bank. Scheduled caste and tribes are not linked to bank. And this is why the government has brought what? Jan Dhan Yojana. Inclusiveness. Right? So they wanted loan waivers. Milk procurement price to be increased, MSP should be increased, and all the recommendations of MN Swaminathan Commission to be finalized or implemented. And from the Marxian perspective, how will you look at this Gaon Band? Farmers' protest, class consciousness, true class, subjective awareness, and a product of pauperization of the agrarian workforce. From Weber's point of view, how you will see this farmers' movement? As an example of causal pluralism, there are a number of reasons which they are, number of grievances which they have expressed. You can't say that only because they are economically poor. Land is not given to the lower caste people because land reform was not successful in India. So without doing the basics, without reading the basics, without correcting the basic problem, fundamental problem, you cannot simply give loan waiver and say that the solution is given to the farmers. It has to start from the genesis. You have to start from the genesis of the problem of the agrarian force today, or agrarian community today, that there is social structure, caste-based land possession is present, and land reform was failure, green revolution was not inclusive in nature, and the monsoon failure because of the globalization, which is affecting the climate very badly, and monsoon failure is because of global warming. And now see how global warming or the ecological imperialism is hitting the farmers. So any answer will have to be woven. Don't just splash the answer. Try to give a story. Let it be a holistic story. When the examiner is reading this answer, he should be thoroughly convinced that your paper is class apart. That is what you have to do. My paper is not 1 in 10,000. I am class apart. Right? And now, Merton, from Merton's point of view, you can write about a disequilibrium, strain, right? And definitely remedy will be what? Functional alternative. What functional alternative the government says? You people are not getting the, proper price for your produce. No, the functional alternative is ENAM, where people of India, majority agricultural community, do not have even literacy. How do they have e-literacy? So functional alternative, R.K. Merton says, it has to be searched within the structural constraint. But when you remove the structural constraint, and you give a functional alternative as a solution, this is only going to add complexities to the already present issue. Right? Anti-beggary law. 2008, when there was Summer Olympics in China, beggars were forcefully removed from the city itself where the Summer Olympics took place. Similarly, 2016 in Brazil, same thing was repeated, that poor people should not be present in the venue of the sports. And when there was Commonwealth Games in 2010, poor people were physically removed from the game area. And recently in Hyderabad, the World Entrepreneur Summit took place. And the poor people were physically removed by the Hyderabad police. Reason is, they are awkward. Reason is what? They are awkward. They will present the image of India as if India is the land of the poor. So naturally, the topic goes to the anti-beggary laws. There is no specific law, but a number of 20 plus states and union territories have their own anti-beggary law, and most of the state laws were derived from the 1959 anti-beggary law of Maharashtra. So anti-beggary law of Bombay only becomes the source of many states to make their anti-beggary law. When you have anti-beggary law, when beggary is an offense which will attract 1 to 3 years of imprisonment, what is sociology in giving jail to one who is poor? Is he poor because he willfully wanted to become poor? Poverty is the most unwanted human experience. No individual wanted to be poor. Everyone wanted to be rich only. So if they are poor because they are choiceless, they are poor because the social structure is the reason for poverty. So individual is not having any solution. Solution will have to come from the structure. Structure should change. Without changing the structure, if you penalize the individual, then this is what is called as insensitivity. The plights of the poor. Vijay Raghavan and Muhammad Tariq and Vijay Raghavan, they have written an article which came in the news. There they heavily criticize this anti-beggary law. It results in criminalization of poverty. R.K. Merton says, structure is the reason, individual is not the reason. Crime is a product of the social structure. Poverty is an outcome of the position of the individual in the social structure. He is not individually the reason for poverty. Destitution, detention, 1 to 3 years of detention will lead to more vulnerability, because when they come out of the jail, again they'll have to become poor. No one will give employment. Stigmatization, because there is a stigma attached to poverty. Poor people are unwanted people. They are outcasted. They are excluded. They are subjected to marginalization. So this you have to write. This thing you have to write in the topic called poverty. Every year you have questions on poverty. Not only in sociology, but also in your GS. You also have this question in your essay. So it is not that sociology stuff only is given. Now you are getting the ingredients to cook your answer as per the demand of the question, boost your score. Poverty breeds crime, according to R.K. Merton. Chronic illness. Poor people will be ill. And poverty is an outcome of family conflict. Poverty is an outcome of breakdown of family support. Poverty is also reality experienced by the aged people and the disabled people. They are subjected to forced migration. Poor people are pushed from their own place. They are dislocated from their own place. These are the problems, or these are the reasons for begging. This is not a choice. This is structurally created, right? Next is, we'll speak some topics which came in the current affairs, which can be used for email dirkim. Can be used in email dirkim, answer related to email dirkim. These are the topics email dirkim has given, which are there in the syllabus. So just I have given the syllabus. Two things we wanted to speak about in this topic. One is organic solidarity. One is organic solidarity, and the other is cultural pluralism. There was another question. There was a question asked last year. Majoritarianism versus minoritarianism debate in sociology was asked. So majoritarianism versus minoritarianism, cultural pluralism, cultural diversity, solidarity, these are the topics under which you can write the thing which we are going to discuss now. I have given the quote of Mahatma Gandhi about the need for cultural pluralism. Simply says, I'll read, I do not want my house to be walled in on sides and my windows to be stuffed. I want the cultures of all the lands to be blown about my house as freely as possible, but I refuse to be blown off my feet by any. So here he speaks about there is a need for cultural pluralism, and one cannot be compelled by the other. I cannot compel by making a law that you should not eat beef. This is against what? Cultural pluralism. What is food to one community may be God to another community. So we cannot force. Every cultural wind can blow in India. Cultural wind can blow in India from all sides. But I will have the right to choose. I will not be compelled by anyone. This is what is more relevant in a globalized world, because globalization resulted in cosmopolitanism. Cosmopolitan culture is emerging today. The presence of diversified cultural groups in one single point, in one single place. And that is what is called as cosmopolitanism. Diversified cultural groups will accumulate in one single point. So I have my culture, you have your culture, she will have her own culture. Nobody can coerce. Nehru says, unity comes because of diversity. And remember, Emile Durkheim in his concept called as organic solidarity speaks about unity because of interdependence, not unity because of uniformity. So when there is a central theme which is enforced on communities, when the culture of the majority is becoming the law of the land, when the culture of the majority becomes the law of the land, culture of the majority is what? Cow is sacred. And that becomes law of the land. Cow cannot be, cow slaughter should not be done. No cow slaughter. Culture of the majority becomes the law of the land. And that is not the intention of the constitution. Constitution gives you cultural pluralism. To read Article 25, it says, anyone can practice any religion of his choice. Article 29 says, fundamental right to conserve my culture. So, Gandhian concept of cultural pluralism or Durkheimian concept of organic solidarity is present in our constitution. Right? When the dominant culture is enforced on the minority, when the majority culture is enforced on the minority, minorities already have insecurity, anxiety. Psychologically speaking, a sense of persecution will be there. That majority will kill minority. That is what is the insecurity feeling present in the mind of the minority. And now adding to their psychological insecurity, when the law is made to thrust the culture of the majority onto the minority, then religiosity of the minority will become astronomically high. Zoya Hazan says, when you enforce your culture onto another culture, naturally there will be a cultural revivalism. And cultural revivalism will be sometimes leading to violence. Lynching today. Lynching men. Why? Because they stored the meat of the cow in the refrigerator. Nothing but a pathology. Because what we are attempting through constitution, we attempt through constitution modern society characterized by organic solidarity. But what we are acting, what is the process, political or economic process, which do today in India, they only enforce tradition onto the modern society. And that is why today, instead of democracy, there is mob violence. I put mob violence separately. People are taking the law in their own hand today. And that is directly challenging the legitimacy of the state institution. Right? Gandhian concept is very relevant because he says that I can bridge the gap between culture. Cultural pluralism will bridge the gap between cultures which arises because of differences. Sociology clearly tells you that when there is a difference, that difference will be evaluated by society as inferior and superior, resulting in discrimination. So it starts as a difference, it ends as a discrimination. But Gandhian concept is a solution for the problem which we are facing today, the majoritarianism, minoritarianism dispute today, that he says that cultural awareness, intercultural awareness, I should have a knowledge about the presence of other cultures. Thereby, I will understand that there are differences and I will tolerate the differences. And in fact, I will even appreciate the differences. So, appreciation of differences by awareness about the presence of other cultures is a solution for violence which is present. Instead of writing violence, you can better use the phrase phenomenology of violence. Right? So, this will add a little bit of flavor to the answer. Adding flavor. Phenomenology of violence, rather than writing simply violence, phenomenology of violence. Right? Phenomenology of violence can be resolved not by excluding certain cultural groups, but by mutual recognition of the cultural differences. So, like one nation, one tax, we cannot promote. One nation, one culture. when we use cultural nationalism, then majority culture will become the culture of the nation. And those who are not subscribing to the culture of the nation, they will be declared as anti-national. Understood? So those who refuse to accept cow as sacred, you are anti-national. Your place is in not India, go to Pakistan. Economically, we can go for integration. But integration refers, integration is needed when there is differentiation, Spencer says. Integration will be needed when there is a differentiation. Allow differentiation. Then you have to create conditions of integration. Integration does not come by annihilation of differences. Integration will not come by annihilation of differences. Cultural annihilation is no solution. Rather, that only will breed violence. So when the question is on minority, majority, when the question is on cultural pluralism, organic solidarity, bring Emile Durkheim, bring Mahatma Gandhi, bring constitution. Why you will not get 320, I am asking? There was an article which came in the news, Why Institutions Matter. June 2018, this article came in the Hindu paper. Rajiv Bhargava is a social scientist whose name can be liberally used. Rajiv Bhargava's name can be liberally used because he speaks on a number of topics ranging from secularism, political history of India, so on and so forth. So, Rajiv Bhargava. Practice, for example, untouchability practice. When there is a practice, the practice is because of the presence of an institution. If you wanted to abolish the practice, you have to abolish the institution. So, abolition of untouchability given in Article 17, right to equality, right against discrimination, Article 15, 16. All these things are speaking about, we have to move towards a caste-less society. So, institution changes, practice changes. Only when institution changes, practice changes. Without changing the institution, you can't change only the practice. Law attempted only to change the practice, but not the institution. That is why law is not effective. There is a topic called as law and social change, given in your paper 2. Law and social change, or constitution and social change. A social practice will have the following features. This is similar to Emile Durkheim's social fact. Social practice, Rajiv Bhargava says, nothing but social fact which already Emile Durkheim told. Collective, repetitive, recurrent, purpose, a common goal will be there. Coordination, cooperation among the actors will be there. And the skills will have to be mobilized, pooled together. So these are the features of practice. It has to be repetitive, it has to have a common goal, it has to have cooperation, and it has to have pooling of the skills. When institution is attacked, the practice also will be attacked. For example, the practice of education suffers when universities are run by capitalists. When universities are run by people who have no understanding about the academic norms. then naturally the process suffers. So institution and practice is affected by institution. When institution is eroded, practice will get eroded. Democracy is at stake. Or if they simply put the question, what are the challenges to Indian democracy in the contemporary times? We have to mention about how democratic institutions, they are attacked today. Democratic institutions are attacked. How? Criminalization of politics. And nexus between money power, muscle power, political power. So this institution is at stake. And what democratic institution will have to practice, this practice also will suffer. The law maker is a law breaker. So corruption present. And this can be a challenge when we are transforming. Institutional credibility is today attacked. Parliament, how parliament functions. How opposition parties are unparliamentary in parliament. So what type of good work which the legislature or the government does. Credibility of the institutions attacked means what institutions should practice. Good practices also will get attacked. Right. So this can be used for email Durkheim's social fact. You can use it for the democracy or challenges before social transformation. All these areas you can use this. Impact of spatial relocation and marginalization of women. If they ask you about the sociology of urbanization, if a very simple question is asked, sociology of urbanization, then you have to write about marginalization of women. A recent study came. K.C. Smita and Barun Debpal. They conducted a recent study. They spoke about how relocation is resulting in problems for women. So a gender perspective of development is needed when you develop the city. Whether it is a smart city or this infrastructural project, you have to have a gendered approach. So inclusiveness is what is the main thrust of given here. Displacement relocation results in marginalization. For example, population is growing and the need of people increases. So the government wanted to go for expansion of the national highway. Or the government wanted to start industries. Now what will happen is, if you don't have a gendered perspective of developmental model, it will create more inequality and it will create more marginalization. This study found that women were convinced to go get relocated because the basic infrastructural facility amenities are not present. Residential complexes are built and women are told to go to, from this slum area, they have to go to the residential complex. When they went to the residential complex, it is not because of their choice, it was a forced relocation. And they found that as long as they were in their own place of settlement, they have multiple job opportunities. But when they went to the new place, they were losing all this multiple job opportunities. And even they are not able to access some basic amenities like health, education. And much of the time they are spending to access healthcare, education and market. Thereby, it furthers the marginalization and impoverishment of women. So, a gender-sensitive developmental model will have to be planned. Study clearly indicated they lost multiple employment opportunity they had was lost. And they have to waste much of their time in trying to access healthcare, education and the market. The result is what? Impoverishment is accelerated rather than empowerment, impoverishment. When they are asking about, say, smart city, sociology of smart city, you can write this. Or they are asking about the problems of urbanization. You can write this. Right? A gender perspective needs to be embedded in the urban planning. And that only is an imperative for inclusive city. A smart city should not be having just infrastructure. A smart city should be an inclusive city. Should be an inclusive city, then only it can become a smart city. So it should not result in impoverishment, it should only result in more and more access to human development. A gender perspective is embedded in the urban planning for an inclusive city. So incorporate gender sensitive measures in designing, planning and implementation of the developmental projects alongside rehabilitation and resettlement. Right? So the problems of development. The topic is development induced displacement. You can write this. Development induced displacement. You can write migration under a topic called migration. You can write about the problems of urbanization. So many things related to paper 2 have the inputs can be used effectively. Next is the study, recent study says there is a new social status which Dalits are experiencing today. They are experiencing social mobility in terms of status. So why? What are the reasons? Before speaking about the new status of Dalits in Bihar, we have to speak about what is status. Status is defined by Max Weber. Status is designed by Louis Dumont. So what Weber says, status is honor. Status means honor. What Louis Dumont says, status is independent of economic and political power. Because status is decided by purity and pollution, the notion of purity and pollution, that decides your status. And purity pollution is independent of economic and political aspects. You can be rich, you can be powerful, but you'll have low status because pollution and purity notion. But however, a critic called us, Ram says, status based on purity and pollution cannot always sustain. It has to be backed by economic forces and political forces. So according to Ram, Dumont is wrong, because only with purity pollution you cannot have a status permanently. It has to be backed by economic and political. So when they are having a new found status, the Dalits of Bihar today, naturally it has to be backed by what? Political power. And that is the reason for emergence of Dalit consciousness. It has to be backed by what? Economic power. So they try to improve their standing in the secular hierarchy. M.N. Srinivas correctly points out that use first secular hierarchy, then you try to improve your ritual hierarchy. There are two important schools of thought which speaks about status. One is Louis Dumont and M.N. Srinivas. Another is David Mandelbaum. Louis Dumont says status is by birth, ascribed status. M.N. Srinivas says status will influence your social relation, it will influence your customs, it influences your way of life. So without changing the status, your life cannot change. Your way of living, your customs will change only when your status changes. So this is one line of thinking about status. And the second line of thinking is McKim, Marriott, David Mandelbaum and Behrman. According to them, status is changing because caste is dynamic. According to Louis Dumont, if you see, Dalits cannot get a new found status because status is by birth. Status is not achieved, status is ascribed. But today when you see Dalits are having a new found status in Bihar, then what McKim Marriott says is appropriate, what David Mandelbaum says is appropriate, that caste system changes. Caste is not a closed system, caste is becoming an open system. Right? Especially in the urban area, caste is diluting. Today, nobody is going to have social relationship based on caste identity in the city. So, urbanization naturally dilutes the caste identity. If you go to village, caste identity is very strong. But when you go to city, caste identity becomes weak. So, urbanization, sociology of urbanization, when you write, you can write this point also. So, urbanization, caste-based discrimination will come down. But another problem will come. Urban places are the epicenter of communal conflict. So you are spared of the caste conflict. You come to city, you find communal conflict present. Communal conflict is an urban phenomena. Caste conflict is a rural phenomena. So conflicts are endemically present in the every walk of life, whether you live in city or you live in villages. Right. What are the reasons for the new status of the Dalits in Bihar? Social consciousness increasing after independence. Because systematically attempts were made by Dr. Ambedkar, right, to improve the consciousness, to develop the consciousness. And this was studied by Owen Lynch, L-Y-N-C-H. And Rajini Kothari says, Dalit consciousness is not just present in the scheduled caste. This consciousness is present in all the oppressed caste, not necessarily SC. So he is preferring to use the term Dalit to all oppressed caste, not only scheduled caste. He says, Dalit consciousness is not just limited to scheduled caste. It has begun to symbolize a much broader spectre of the oppressed and the hitherto excluded from the social strata. So Dalit is an identity. Dalit is an identity. Which type of identity? An assertive identity. Every year they are asking a question on the rising Dalit consciousness. When you write in a recently made study, the new found status of Dalits in Bihar found that the causes of the new found statuses. One is emergence of Dalit consciousness. And second is Sanskritization. Third is there are a number of socio-religious reform movement which had an impact. Right? For example, Satya Sodak Samaj of Jyotiba Phule. And constitution definitely gives a protective discrimination or affirmative action. And most importantly, people are moving away from the irrational prejudices. Right? They themselves are moving away, especially in city and all. The irrational practice in the name of caste system, we are not ready to follow. Generally, people move, and that is an outcome of modernization. As Yogendra Singh rightly points out, modernization can result in what? That there is a change, no? From the irrational practices, you move to rational practices. So we are rationalizing our religious rituals. And people of upper caste have gradually, they are gradually moving away from irrational practices, traditional practices, and they are also moving away from the inhibition they had before with respect to Dalits. So constitutional protection, SCST Act, all these things are an important change in the life of the Dalit sections, and that is why their status has increased, has improved a lot in Bihar. Right? Next point is, or next topic, 10th topic is class caste differences in the access to agricultural credit. And this is an article which came in the TPW magazine. In fact, I am referring to the magazine name only to some topics, not to all other topics. Just to make you know that how sociological stuffs are repeatedly coming in the magazines or the newspaper, which is not entirely for civil services. Right? You can use this in agriculture of paper 2, caste paper 2, stratification paper 1. These are the topics. Or farmers movement paper 2. Dantwala earlier told that credit is very important for ability. Agricultural credit is more important for social mobility. Way back in 1950s, Dantwala said. And what NSSO 2014 says, 86.4% of the farmers are in the small farm size category. They own only less than 2 acre, 2 hectare, and majority of them are belonging to marginalized caste. So this is an NSSO data. Even if you write it is 2018, nobody is going to question, because almost this is same only. This is not going to change. But to be more authentic, you write even 2014. 86% are small owners, small landowners. And most of the time, small owners, landowners are belong to the lower caste. Now what happens when the banks are giving loan? They are discriminating. Lower caste people are not given loan. Upper caste people, upper class people are given loan. So if you wanted to take study loan, there is so much of formalities present. But if you wanted to take car loan, no formality present absolutely. That is why many people have taken loan and they are absconding from India. Easily they got loan. Now, just by cancelling the ration card, what we expect him to come to India or to go out of India, stay out of India permanently. So bank access is very, very less for the scheduled caste is what is the recent study. Formal credit is very crucial to agriculture, but it also should be very inclusive. All the lower classes or lower caste groups also should be given credit facility. Kumar, in his recent study, found that bank bureaucracy access only available for the big farmers, not for the small farmers, whether it is formal institution or informal financial institution, only big farmers can access the bank bureaucrat. So rich farmer can easily talk to the bank manager. So access is very restricted only to the big farmers, not to the small peasants. Mekarotra study 2011. Non-inclusiveness of the commercial banks. Commercial banks are excluding the small farmers. But Jodhka and Kumar says commercial banks are inclusive. Commercial banks are giving loan even to the poor farmer, but only the cooperative banks are not giving loan to the poor farmers, because cooperative banks are controlled by dominant caste people. So bank access to the poor is what is the topic of study. Caste class differences in access to agricultural credit. Krishna, he says there are three topics which he is studying. One is engineering, another is business management, and third is civil services. So in these areas, he found that those people having social capital, they are able to get success, unlike other people who do not own this cultural capital. So naturally, your individual achievement is not important for mobility. What is important for mobility is cultural capital. This concept of cultural capital was used by Pierre Bourdieu. Engineering, business, civil services. Who are successful? A recent study says those people who have a family background, they are highly successful. And this is what is the topic which we already know in paper 1, unit number 5. Mobility, elite self-recruitment, there is one concept, elite self-recruitment. So easily, if father is IAS, son can become IAS. Easily, if father is a business magnate, son can become. Easily, if father is engineering graduate, son can become. So the reason is they have some extra advantage because of the family background. And this is what is called as cultural capital. Srinivas also studies the Coorgs of South India. He is not using cultural capital, but when he is speaking about Sanskritization, he mentions about cultural capital only. Marxian study is not speaking about cultural capital, it is only speaking about economic capital. Now, a small point on what this cultural capital means, it is non-economic goods. For example, education. Brahmins have Carnatic music as their cultural capital. So, it is very difficult for a non-Brahmin to become a Carnatic musician, because Carnatic music is a cultural capital owned by Brahmins. Now come to this cultivated dispositions. Cultural capital refers to cultivated dispositions. So these are internalized by you because of the socialization process. Cultural symbols. Language is a cultural symbol. So naturally, those elite group, they will speak in English at home only, and English becomes very important language for you to clear the examination, and this is what is called as cultural capital. So those people who are coming from the elite background, They are very good in maths and English, and now CSAT is introduced, they will clear. That is what is called as cultural capital. Those coming from the rural areas will be totally cut off. Iverson says that cultural capital is not present in SEST, the rural people, and that is why they are not able to get upward mobility. Right? So when you speak about caste system, when you speak about tribes, why the problems of tribes? A very simple question they have asked many times. What are the problems faced by the tribes in India? They have asked particularly vulnerable tribal groups. So what are the tribal problems? You can write that the normal points are there, that they are not in the plain area, they are in the hill area, they are geographically in separate area, all these stuff. But you should write that their problem is perpetuating because one is they don't have a reference group. Who will be emulated by you? They don't have adequate successful groups to be emulated. Because the success of you will be dependent on the reference group which you are choosing. R.K. Merton says this. They don't have a reference group, proper reference group, successful reference group. And they are also not having cultural capital, and that is why they are not able to experience intergenerational mobility across generations, all generations. They are in the same ladder of the social hierarchy. So Iverson, cultural capital not present in SEST, and that is the reason why they are not able to experience upward mobility. Rural background is also one important limitation for upward mobility. If you are present in rural areas, then definitely you don't have the opportunity for upward mobility, and you don't have proper reference group. So that is why when you speak about the rural urban divide, you can bring this thing that the rural people are not having reference group which can be emulated by them to become successful, and they don't have the cultural capital, as a result of which the rural urban divide keeps on expanding. So providing urban amenities in rural area pura should not only speak about increasing the infrastructural connectivity or the Gram Sadak Yojana, PM Gram Sadak Yojana, or the important social sector schemes should not only create community assets, they have to allow the access of not just economic capital but also cultural capital. Then only the downtrodden people will experience upward mobility. Next is certain topics related to the protest, agitation, social movements and all. Mobocracy challenges democracy. A number of mob violence, increasing lynchings, increasing mob violence, especially in villages of Maharashtra, Tripura, was reported because of the social media message about the child lifters, right? So some people, they were wrongly identified as child lifters and they were killed, and that is a message which is spread through the social media. Why mob is taking the school, why they are breaking the law, why they are taking law on their own hand, right? So this is a very serious concern, because when there is a mob violence is speaking about unorganized power. State is speaking about organized power. Whenever the unorganized power challenges to the organized power, then organized power will retaliate using repressive measures. And that is why firing incident. That is why when there is a protest, when there is a mob violence, retaliation is firing. So only through development the moral accountability of the state can be ensured, social conflict can be reduced. So when they are asking about all this lynching, increasing mob violence, then you can use this dysfunctions of technology. Science, technology and social change can be a topic where you can add this point, or you can even speak about the problems of protest, which is there in the 7th unit of your paper 1. Electronic rumor mongers produce a chilling effect on open society. So electronic rumor mongers produce a chilling effect on the open society. Structural strain because of mob violence. R.K. Merton says structural strain because of mob violence. Insecurity, climate of insecurity. Electronic rumor mongers produce a chilling effect on the very idea of a open society, right? Now we will speak about the problem which is faced by the homosexuals. As Supreme Court is, they are pronouncing judgment on IPC 377. Homosexuality can be a topic. Sociology of homosexuality or sociology of IPC 377, section 377. There is a study conducted by Afroz Alam and Bhattacharya. They prefer to use the term called as neo-marginalized community. A community is a neo-marginalized community in the modern society. Stigmatization of homosexuals. So they are stigmatized. Shame. Homosexuals are treated with shame. They are newly marginalized people. Earlier, poor people were marginalized people. The lower caste people were marginalized people. Women were marginalized people. SCSTs were marginalized people. But today, gays are new marginalized people or neo-marginalized people. Right? It comes in the news because of the Supreme Court observation on section 377 of IPC. They are considered by the society physically, morally, socially, economically, medically, legally untouchable. They are new untouchables. Right? There is a study conducted by Levine in 2002. It says, heterosexual norm is the creation of the majority. So majority is imposing this heterosexual norm on all people. If you deviate from this heterosexual norm, then they are outcasted. They are physically punished. Stigmatization of homosexual, neo-marginalized gay community in the modern society. Untouchable they are. A new untouchable. Economically, medically, legally, morally untouchable. And the heterosexual norm is the norm of the mainstream society. Stigmatization invisibilizes the deviant population. The main society wanted to make the gay population invisible. So attempts are made by the dominant sections of the society to invisibilize the deviant population. Plummer says it is a social construct. Homosexuality is a social construct to pathologize sexual minorities. Homosexuals are called as sexual minorities. Homosexuality is a social construct to pathologize sexual minority. Pathologize sexual minority. Next topic is the violent protest by Dalits against the Supreme Court order on the SCST Act. March 20, 2018, Supreme Court gave a guideline to prevent the misuse of this SCST Act 2018. Now, why this is taking an important center stage in the current discourses, in the current affairs? Lakhs of Dalits have started protesting against the Supreme Court judgment. This is not the first time. In the recent time, a number of such Dalit protests can be seen. For example, Jan 2016, Rohit Vemula, and July 2016, Yuna attack on Dalits, and 2018, attacks on the celebration of 200 year anniversary celebration of Bhima Koriga battle in Maharashtra. Because this battle, which was taking place in 1818, 200 years over, and this battle is a battle which is seen as the success of the Dalits over the Peshwas. Peshwas were defeated by Dalits who were more present in the British army. So when they wanted to commemorate this 200th year anniversary, they were attacked by the upper caste or the dominant caste. Mahars were present more in the British army, who fought a battle against Peshwas in 1818, and the British won. So it was hailed as the success of Mahars against the Peshwas. When they wanted to celebrate, it was attacked. The celebration, 200th year anniversary celebration, resulted in attack against the Dalits. The reason is mobility. Affirmative actions attempted to undo the historical damage. Affirmative actions have attempted to undo the historical wrongs. As a result of the policies, as a result of the protectionist policies sponsored by constitution and law, naturally there is an emergence of Dalit middle class. So this Dalit middle class becomes revolutionary. They are the one to lead the revolution. History of social protest says leadership will come from middle class. History of social revolution says, or social protest says, leadership comes from the middle class. So today, Dalits are rewriting their own history, their own biographies. Dalit assertivism. Commemoration of the 200 year anniversary of the battle. To declare their success over the Mahar, success over the Peshwas. This is what is assertiveness. And this comes under Dalit mobilization or Dalit consciousness. They are demanding reservation not as a matter of concession, but today as a matter of right. Next topic is, there is a tribal group called as, particularly they are Katkari tribes who belong to particularly vulnerable tribal group. And these tribal groups are the lowest in the tribal hierarchy. 2011 statistics says they have the lowest literacy rate, 41%. Lowest proportion of cultivators, 5%. They are the lowest in the social hierarchy by other tribes. And other tribes don't even get water from this tribe. So this is putting an important question mark on, is tribal society an egalitarian society? Because we know that caste society is hierarchical society, but tribal society is relatively egalitarian society. Another study is there. I will show another study which was recently conducted, which says that the tribal societies are relatively egalitarian society. So it depends upon the question which they are asking, because to tell that tribal society is practicing hierarchy, you have this study. To tell that tribal society is egalitarian, you have another study. So now you have both the perspectives. When you read the question, you understand the demand of the question. As a result, as a response to the question, you have to mend your answers, because you know this side also, you know that side also. When the question is open to you, then you can take your choice. But when question compels you to write in a particular way, you have to write in that particular way only. So you just read the question, understand whether it is an open-ended question or they are telling you to write only a particular version. Use the inputs which we are giving today according to the demand of the question. So they are lowest in the social hierarchy of the tribes. They are even more subjected to social discrimination. Satkari tribes. Rohit Mutakar is using a concept called as ascribed deprivation. Ascribed deprivation faced by the Satkari tribes in Maharashtra, who are particularly vulnerable tribal group. There was a question I have told before also, particularly vulnerable tribal group was a question asked. So these are the recent discourses or the recent sociological studies which came in the news. Can help you to, this points can help you to enrich your answers. Rohit Mutakar, ascribed deprivation means birth-based deprivation. They are born in the, children will be born in the poor tribal family. Ultimately, they will also become very poor. So, the economic process and the political process or the social process is reinforcing your ascribed status. And this is no exception even for the tribal society, which is supposed to be an egalitarian society. Right? So, ascribed deprivation means birth-based deprivation continues in the Katkari tribes. I have told you this study is speaking about some positive aspects of the tribal society, Sumi Krishna study. The study is on gender relations in the Adivasi societies, especially the northeastern India. Tribes studies were studied, tribes were studied by Sumi Krishna. It says good things about the gender relations present in the northeastern tribes. They are more egalitarian. Division of labor is very flexible. Political spaces characterized by gender equality. And women can new to political spaces. They can go to nomadic way to a settled life. So it is highly possible that social change becomes easy when you give egalitarian status to women. They are shifting easily from semi-nomadic type to settled way of life. And this speaks about how tribal society is characterized by gender equality. Compare tribe with caste. There is a concept called as tribe-caste continuum. So tribe and caste can be compared, and you can also find some sort of linkage. So tribe-caste continuum, you can use which is tribe, Satkari tribe study. Because like in caste system, there is present hierarchy. Like in caste system, there is present ascriptive status or ascriptive deprivation. So Sumi Krishna's study on northeastern tribes speaks something which is very positive about gender equality present in the northeastern tribes. The status of denotified tribe in undivided Andhra Pradesh. A recent study, Vijay Kora study. September 2017. The study speaks about discrimination and stigma faced by the DNT, denotified tribe. 34% of the DNTs were called by their caste name. So when we call somebody by caste name, then it is seen as an indicator of discrimination. Calling by caste name is a discrimination. Educational status of the DNT. 61% of DNTs are illiterate people. Denotified tribes. Vijay Kora study 2017. Discrimination and stigmatization. 34% are addressed by their caste name. 61% of them are illiterate. There are 20 occupations which they are practicing. They are into 20 occupations. 17% of them are in non-farmers, non-farm labor. They are offering non-farm labor force. 10% are only in agriculture. 12% are petty traders. And they are having identity crisis today because of the statutory backup. Legal support is not there for them. And they are not able to avail the social sector benefits. Because they are illiterate, they are very poor, and still there is a stigma, and they are not beneficiaries of any social sector initiative. Patal Gadi movement in Jharkhand, June 2018. They have a practice of writing on the stone with respect to any important occasion. They wanted some sort of territorial demarcation. Everything will be written in the stone. This practice is called as Patal Gadi practice. What they did recently was, they declared that they are going to form an all Adivasi government. Jharkhand movement 1990. Tribes of Jharkhand wanted economic, educational empowerment. So they were the torch bearers or the backbone of the Jharkhand movement, Jharkhand tribes. Because of their effort, after 10 years, that is in 2000, Jharkhand was created as a separate state. Three new states were created, one was Jharkhand. But look at today, the Jharkhand tribes, they wanted separation from the state. As secessionism is present in this declaration, what they say is, we will create our own defense department, education department, health department. So they are declaring themselves independent of the government, it seems. This is not just an anti-national movement. It is not only having anti-national component. It is also preventing the tribes to get integrated into the mainstream. So this is get a question on identity based movements. There is one social movement in paper too. Identity based movements are there. Ethnicity and identity based movement is there in the syllabus. You can have this thing written in the identity based movement, that June 2018, the Patal Gadi movement was started by Jharkhand by declaring themselves independent. They will form an independent all Adivasi government, independent of the state government. So this is an example of subnationalism, and this prevents them to get integrated into the mainstream society. The reasons are what? Jharkhand is highly infested by Maoism, Naxalism. So that may be the reason. Naxalism is the main reason. Unemployment is the main reason. Acceleration of poverty, land grabbing by the corporate for mining. These are the reasons for which there is so much of, you know, protest among the Jharkhand tribes. So the reasons are, Adivasi areas of India witnesses bloodletting. So much of bloody conflicts are happening in the Adivasi area. Reason is, violence is because of lack of development. The main reason for violence is lack of development. And there is Maoism, which is very strongly present. And the tribal people have not seen the light of 21st century. Globalization is not helping the tribal population. As a result of which, this Patal Gadi movement took place in June 2018 in Jharkhand. Right? We'll stop here. We will continue in the next class. The next class will be on Saturday, same time. right? So 11th of August, we have the next class. I've told you number of hit list topics are there. We'll do one by one. So 3 to 4 classes I wanted to cover around 100 topics.